Today, I would like to talk about automated server management with some open source tool. My name is Balazs Pocze, and I hope you will enjoy this. I'm not really sure if I will show really new thing for everybody, but I hope there will be some things today. First of all, I would like to say about who we are or who I am for. We are Gawker. We are mostly a blogging service. We have a bunch of really good blogs. I recommend to read them. We get around 100 million unique in every month. We get about 60 million monthly. So we are not that big, but we are big enough to say we are the largest independent media company of the world. We got a platform called Kinja. You can register on your own Kinja there if you want. It's up to you, but read the blogs. Our traffic is mostly about red traffic, so we don't have to deal with really fancy performance issues. But at the end of the day, it's quite interesting, I guess, what I can show you right now. First of all, I would like to talk about why do we need automation, and I'm pretty hope that all of us will agree on the same things, and in a perfect world, and I don't show any new things for any of you in the beginning of my presentation. Automation is good, and everybody just needs automation. For example, if you like to do DevOps, which is just a synonym for automation, I think. You have to use these tools, or you could use these tools as well. Every company has way less operations people than developers. I think we can agree on that, except if you are in a consulting company. These developers who has to do something on your running system often know what to do, I mean, what they want to do on the system, like they need a failover, they need anything like that, but you can't expect all of them to know all the fancy commands for that or even the knowledge to SSH for a computer. I think we all know that the man hours are very expensive, so it's really a waste if you spend the man hours on doing the same routine test. For example, I don't think that any of you have backups like manually. And of course, if you automate the test, that will mean that it won't fail. I mean, it can fail as well, but it won't fail like a mistyping or something like that. Everything is scripted, everything is nice, but we have a lot of servers. I bet you have a lot of servers as well. And for that, we need some very good framework to do the automation stuff, and I will talk about this framework later. Of course, we can make jokes about that not all tasks were the automation itself, because how many times you will shave off in a 5-year long period, but I totally don't agree with that, because you don't want to waste any of your people's minds on doing routine tasks. You mostly want your operations people happy and productive, so just take the audit and visit XKCD because it's funny. I don't know if you are familiar with that situation. I have worked a lot with people like her. I mean, how many you encountered guys who, like, I don't know, committed and pushed to the master and went to hiking for 2 days and something like that? Well, it never happens at Gawker because we don't let this. And the way to don't let this is that everybody gets involved in the real traffic. I mean, if there is a front-end developer who pushes a code online, then he or she has to do anything with that in the future. I mean, they are the first responders of the on-calls, and they only come to the operations if there's really, really, really broken something. So for help them to this, I mean, to achieve this point, we have to provide them tools to monitor and control the behavior of the production environment. But for that, we really need to build up tools, which is really useful for that. I don't want any of the developers to able to SSH to the servers. It's a bug. It's rather a bug. Of course, sometimes it's just unavailable. Sorry, that's a hard word for me. But often you just don't want them to allow that. And of course, I do want the developers to do the routine operation tasks as well. For example, if they need a new dev server, there's two ways to do that. Ask a DBA for that, or just get to the store and get one. I think the second way is the much better way for that. Right now, I will talk a bit about our stack, because I brought some examples how we automate, and for that I do want you to understand the whole way we are living or something like that. Here are the system's key elements. Of course, we are running on Linux. We have a bunch of physical machines, but right now we are in the middle of migrating to the cloud. We use a software called Cobbler for the hardware. We use a software called Puppet for provisioning all the hosts. We use Ansible. Ansible is nice for running these commands on the host, and we use Jenkins for continuous integration. So I think we can talk about this stuff one by one. Of course, we use Linux because it is the de facto standard for internet-based companies. How many of you have websites or something like that? And how many of you are not running it on Linux? Right? It's really good to use Linux. Linux is open source and it's free, and that's really nice because it's not just free as beer, but free as freedom, and it won't vendor lock you into anything. You just open the switch on Linux, and it's really good for you. And open source is very much better because it just brings you a way of doing things. If you use open source software, that will mean that you tend to open source your own scripts and give them back to the community. I think that's nice. We have physical hardware. I don't know why I put there that we are running on multiple data centers. It's just interesting. But the most important thing here, that all of our machines are nearly the same. And that's really important, because if you use the same vendor's hardware on all your problems and you try to put the same generation of hardware there, that will much more easy, makes your thing easier with that, because you only have write the scripts which will monitor the hardware once, and then you can, you know, just exchange the hardware. Needless to say, if you keep your hardware as close as possible, I mean the same amount of RAM, the same type of disk, and so on, that could lead to a very, very marvelous position when you can just simply exchange your hardware when you need something. It's a cloudish thing, but it's not. We are migrating to cloud on purpose, of course. The first software I would like to talk about is Cobbler. The italic part is taken from Google, and I don't want to read it out loud because it would be awkward. But the point is, using Cobbler, Cobbler is an installation server for Red Hat and CentOS. You can put your Kickstart files there, and Cobbler will do the rest. If you have a host defined in Cobbler, then if you bring up that machine, it will ask on bootp for Kickstart, it TFTP, it gets an IP from DHCP, it will be put on the DNS, it will create a reverse DNS, and that means you don't have to ever touch the DHCP or DNS config. And you just have the tool where you can insert a new hardware into your ecosystem or remove it. And the tool itself not just manages, but also defines it. So it's kind of a single source of truth about all your machines. I think it's really important to get. No. The question was that, do we use Cobbler for Ansible host files as well? No, they are auto-generated. I take that later. We use Puppet. How many of you maybe use Puppet? how many of you use this on another provisioning stuff? Along with Puppet? Cool. Well, we use Puppet because we started to use Puppet, and that's the whole reason. Chef is pretty good, SourceTalk is pretty good. I don't like Ansible as provisioning stuff, but it is just me, so that doesn't mean anything. But with Puppet, you can manage a large set of hosts. Doesn't matter how many hardware you have. You can host your Puppet code on GitHub or, you know, just pick one of the source control systems. And as well, it defines all the hosts. If a host is not in the Puppet, then that host is just not exist. In fact, the Cobbler's database resides in our Puppet, so Puppet is the real single source of truth. Ansible. How many of you are using Ansible? Okay, it's quite nice. I mostly just talk about Ansible. But for the rest, we use it just for automation. You can provision a host with Ansible as well. I don't really like it because in Puppet you define, like, I have a host and this kind of host I need this package to be installed, and if it's not installed, it will install there. I mean, Puppet, when Puppet runs, it just downloads the RPM or dev or something and installs that. But with Ansible, you have to write a framework for that, and you can just give commands for that. It's more imperative than describing, so I don't like for that. But I do like it for automation, and I do like it for opening connections to all the hosts, because it's really easy to use. If the host where you host the Ansible can SSH to any of your hosts or Puller shell, it's just there. But if you can SSH to a host, then Ansible will work, and it is really, 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 really good. You can organize your commands into playbooks, and playbooks are really neat because they are like scripts, just really easy to read. I said it's agentless, and it's open source, so you can create your modules, and they take it. From Gawker, we contributed MySQL application module, we contributed module for NetScaler load balancers, and they just accepted it, and it's all Ansible right now, so they really care. A few words before I start showing code about our architecture, because I just brought here an automated task example to show you, and I just would like to put you in, like, you know, in the knowledge of what I'm talking right there about. We have a lot of application servers, and we run JVMs on the application servers. The application is created in Scala, and Scala compiles to JVM. There's a reason. On each application server, we have AJ proxy with two backends, one backend for the MySQL masters and one backend for the replicas. And it makes really easy to, like, I don't know, do a failover or just remove replica from live service or put that back on. That will be my example. I guess that's a really, really clean stack or something like that. Here's the replication map. It's a replication map itself. The point is we have two data centers, and one data center is more equal than the other. So all the writes will go to the primary master, and the secondary master act as a slave as well, and there are much more slaves down. I show this to you because if we have time at the end, I will do some replication layout changes, and I just want to show you where do I will do that. Let's talk about the playbooks, and this is the automation part itself. I said automation, well, it's more scripting than automation. I mean, right now I have to trigger, or the developers have to trigger this stuff, so it's not that kind of automation which involves machine learning or something like that. But right now the stack is just prepared for that, so if you can script the intelligence into that, then it will work as well. Here's an example Ansible playbook. most of you have probably seen that. It's an YAML file, which is really good, because everything you can describe in XML, you can describe in YAML, but it's much easier to read YAML. And I don't think that XML is for human beings. YAML is good for humans and computers as well. In an Ansible playbook, you can decide on which host you want to run the playbook. Like in this playbook, I put a variable app server for the host so I can inject anything. The gather facts part is about, do we want to run the puppet factor module before we run the whole playbook? It just sets up some variables on the host. I can define which user I do want to run this playbook. In that host, I do want to run that with root. Please don't do that in production. You can define the serial, like how many servers you want to run the commands parallel. Pretty easy to understand, just a playbook, it's really good. There are some tasks. I put an include vars task here. It's not because it's doing anything, but it is a very good way to inject, for example, secrets into playbooks. We host our code in GitHub, and I don't want to put like connection credentials and something like that put into this kind of playbooks. We use Git crypt for encrypt few of the files in our Git repository and in our automation repository at Git. So this many slave variables, it just sat in an encrypted file on GitHub. Nobody can touch it, but in this way, I can just take variables on the running system. There's only three tasks: drain connections, waiting a bit, and disabling the slave. You can see that these commands are just shell commands, and I don't do anything else, just echo something into an AJ proxy's stats module, stats socket. So if you use AJ proxy, you probably use that or did the same. So when I run this playbook, it will open a connection to the app server, and then it echoes the set server slave slash slave name read zero to a pipeline, and it's pretty nice, I guess. Right now not, but I really enjoyed a presentation about what, so I will. I'm sorry? He was asking that I didn't use what for managing secrets and answers. I will. I totally will, but right now it's not in what. Here's the opposite one. It just enables the slave. Just goes back to service and then gives back the weight. It's not a big deal. But what is a bit more interesting is about how you run these playbooks. I mean, there's a very good command for the Ansible playbook, and it's pretty easy to understand everything. You just provide a playbook, you can inject variables, and it runs. And it's really good because you see on which host it run, there's the line to play, which task I do run right now, the include variables. You can see that it's green, it succeeded. The drain connection, it's yellow, that means something changed in the system. We wait, and after the wait, we just disable the slave, and at the end, I get a really good play recap, and I just seen what happened. It's really good to know. For example, if we do software deployment, which, you know, which really long, it takes about 5 minutes or something like that, at the end I can just see on which host it was succeeded or not. It's cool. Here's the opposite one. I don't think that anything should be told about this. There's a habit of me that I do like these old Unix-ish and Linux-ish things, and I always create wrappers for the playbooks. I create these wrappers because I just want to avoid all that kind of human errors, which could be if you, which can happen when you do it manually. So for all the Ansible, all the tasks which I want to automate, I create a shell wrapper, and the shell wrapper will call for the Ansible playbooks. If it is easy, it will be a shell wrapper. It is a bit more complex. It can be Python or Go, something like that. But right now, for example, for slave management, I have a script called manage slave. I can parameter it, and it just will call the Ansible playbooks as well. like this. It's not the best example, I guess, because the command line is almost the same as before, but at least I don't have to deal with multiple playbook names. The last part is Jenkins, which is a build bot. And the point with Jenkins is that Jenkins is a continuous integration and continuous delivery application, whatever it means. We already used Jenkins before we started Automate because the Scala code needs to be compiled and you don't want the developer to compile on your own computer, so Jenkins could take all the tasks for that. So Jenkins was there, and because every project has its own workplace and own logs and own everything, they just reside next to each other. It's easy to see all the history of the previous build. You can, you know, you can just get all the information you need. Jenkins is really good to run tasks through Jenkins. For example, here's a picture of the operations, part of operations jobs in our Jenkins. I'm pretty sure that you don't really see it really good. But the point is, on the first column, you can see green dot or gray dot or even a red dot. It's about, you can easily see that was your task last time succeeded or didn't. You can see a weather report that means it's normally succeeded or not. The names, you can see success times, failure times, last duration, stuff like that. You can rerun the last run, for example, if a deploy wasn't successful, then you can rerun the previous deploy and don't have to take time to revert the code, compile the application, and deploy the new code. So Jenkins is just good for that, but it's really ugly, right? Here's an example job page. This job page is for enable and disable a slave, and it's quite the same. You can see the preview builds, you can see the state of this project so far. You can configure it, and this task or this command just resides in this workplace. Here's an example of Jenkins command output. This is really small, so I'm pretty sure that you don't see that. But if maybe, then you can see that it's almost the same as the command line output. So I just run Ansible playbooks through Jenkins, and I get the same output. So it's really good because I start to run anything, or a developer start to run anything, and we can just share the Jenkins URL with the Slack, and we can see what happens. There is no need to open a screen, TMUX, and run the commands inside, because that part is just covered with Jenkins. Here's an example of Jenkins job configuration, which is one of the worst things I ever seen. It's really bad to use. At the end of the day, it just, you know, creates an XML, and you don't, it's really bad to use. So please avoid to use that. And for luck, there's a very good thing for that, and it's called Jenkins Job Builder. Jenkins Job Builder just generates Jenkins config for YAML files as well. I have to take back one slide, sorry. Before I took the Jenkins Job Builder, I just messed up these two slides, I guess. I want to talk about the Jenkins API is really good. I mean, it has a REST API, it has a CLI API, so it is really easy to just trigger jobs to run through Jenkins. Like, you can use curl, you can use wget, you can use a common Jenkins. So that's really nice, and you can trigger jobs from jobs. Like, I don't know, for example, every day I take a backup from the live system, and that triggers a job which will rebuild the development database based on the newest backup, which is good for me because if the backup is broken, I get noticed about that. And it is good for the devs because they just have a fresh backup about database. And if they do want to do, if they do something very nasty in the dev database, they just could ask for a new one and it just happens. So Jenkins API is really good for this. So here's the Jenkins Job Builder, which helps you to avoid this all nasty Jenkins configuration things. You can write your own YAML files for that as well. You can put these definitions to GitHub. It makes your Jenkins instance this possible. Our Jenkins instance right now is a Docker image, which is run on the physical hardware, but I'm pretty sure that at the end of this day, my colleagues will make the new Jenkins instance inside the Google Cloud. So it's pretty good. I don't know who was the guy who created this stuff, but it's pretty good. Here's a way how a Jenkins job builder job looks like it's a YAML, and as well, it starts with a job. You can put as many jobs as you want inside, of course. It has a name, how you will relate to this file or relate to this job. Description for reading out that, there's display name. I think it's pretty easy to follow. I mean, there's nothing inside which anybody needs to understand. Only interesting thing, I guess, is two things. One of that, you can put parameters, which is really good because these parameters will be used later as the parameters of scripts. And for example, when I do the automation stuff, I have a database server rebuild job, for example, and in the CLI wrapper, I can rebuild any of the MySQL masters online from the other servers, but I didn't put the masters on the Jenkins. So if somebody just approaches the Jenkins and starts that job, he or she won't be able to break the entire system, which I guess it's a generally good idea. The choices could be anything. I mean, they could be strings, they could be booleans, they could be, name it, integers, whichever you need. And at the end of this whole file, there are the builders, which practically right now it's a freestyle project, you can see on the third line. So the builder is just a command which will SSH to any of the hosts. Doesn't matter right now what the Docker has been there, and runs my managed slave script with the parameters taken from here. So it's not a big deal. And I don't think that I really showed new things, but this way of gluing this stuff together is pretty working for me. And it's pretty working for my colleagues as well. So I hope I have shown really nice things, but here's a recap about the big picture. We have the playbooks, we have the CLI wrappers for these playbooks, we have the Jenkins jobs, which will call the CLI wrappers. We're able to run all the commands through the Jenkins, and the commands will report to Slack. The question was that because my Jenkins is this possible, that how I trigger the BR jobs. Yes, it's GitHub that hook. And GitHub talks to Jenkins, and it's really good. The this possible things only made one problem for us, and it was that before we made it this possible, we really relied on the build numbers on the script. And that was bad because we had to keep the volume of the Jenkins accessible, and it just grown and grown and grown, and it wasn't really good. But there's a very good plugin for Jenkins which can help you get over that bigger numbers. Jenkins is open source and it has a pool of plugins. Practically, if you're curious about Jenkins, know this or this, you will find a plugin for that. Not all plugins are in the best state, so read them, but most of them are really okay. I'm a bit faster than I expected. I sorry, I can't understand you. No, not yet. I will check that out later. Could you show me? Thank you. I use Jenkins because Jenkins was there, and that was the reason of Jenkins. But right now, the operations jobs and the development jobs and some of the live system jobs are residing in the same Jenkins, and because of the Jenkins runners, we always fighting against the resource. So it could be good. You can ask me right now if you have questions, or I can demo some stuff in or the live system of ours. Then demo time. I have two GitHub repos. I mean, I have my own, and I have the company has its own. There are scripts which I use from mine, so you can check them out. And there are a few scripts which we open source from the company repo as well. So I plan to do two things. I will take out from traffic one of the application servers, and when I did that, I will put that to another place of the replication chain, and then I will do that backward. So here's an Apple One in one of the data centers. This looks pretty nice. You can see the name of the master database, the DB master DFC. The secondary master is not on the right, and four slaves are available to use. So in Jenkins, I only thing I have to do that I go and find this enable disable MySQL slave, which I've shown so far. I will build it with parameters. I select the slave which I want to disable. It's a pretty good part for that. And I just say disable that one, please. You can see that the command just started running. All the app servers will be removed that slave. Fortunately, I'm inside this slave. And we can see that how the connection will be drained there. I just put the slave into a drain state. And right now, we just wait until the applications are just will spread across the other slaves as well. I never thought 1 minute can be so long if you stand in front of a lot of people. Right. Sure. The question was, do I use Ansible other thing than Sandy commands? And yes, I do. But I mainly script them. For example, if I have to, I don't know, reclone a MySQL slave, it's an Ansible playbook for that. And the Ansible playbook will use, like, I don't know, I will SSH to a host, I will remove the old MySQL part, I will open, I will stream a backup there, I will bring up the interface, I will set up the MySQL application with the MySQL application module and put that server back to traffic. And of course, I can glue these parts together. So for example, if you want to rebuild a slave in, which is running in traffic, then first I can run the disable, I can run the rebuild stuff, and so on. You can see that almost all the connections are gone. I know that all these connections are not from the live traffic. And you can see that this slave this was put to maintenance mode. So right now I take this slave. I take the job. which is the change application master job, and I will run it on the slaver one, BFC, and I put that under, let's say, the secondary master. That triggers the Ansible playbook as well. It runs, and here's the new replication layout. The slaver one was just moved under this, the DB secondary. So it's pretty nice, I guess. Good thing to know about Jenkins that you have to switch off buffering mode, like Python unbuffered, or in Perl you can deal with the dollar pipe symbol. Because if you don't do that, you will only get output when the commands are finished. If you shut down the buffering, the Jenkins will report normally. So it's really good. So right now I have a slave under a secondary server, but right now I will rerun this job because I don't want to make my colleagues worried what happened. So I put back slave 1 under its original master server. In fact, it's really good to deal with GTID because you don't have to take anything like which build-up positions we are and stuff like that. With GTID, it's literally just a command which will run the stop slave and change master to master. And yes? And the next iteration will be that because Jenkins is really good scriptable by REST API, that I do want to adapt these GitHub's chatops things, because just think about that. Everybody's on Slack or in HipChat or ERC or whatever you use. And there's somebody goes to a Jenkins, starts the Jenkins job, parameters it, starts it, and the Jenkins will report to HipChat, ERC or something like that. But it is much easier if you have a bot and you say, hey Jenkins bot, could you please rebuild the slave for me, like slaver 1, and it can trigger the Jenkins job as well, and things can happen, and everybody will be happy because it's just in front of your eyes. So I move back the slave to its original position. So the last thing I do want to do with that server is to put back the traffic, which is quite easy. Like, I only need to enable the same MySQL slave. And it's a way shorter command run. If it just moves back to the AJ proxy part, and soon, I do this like that. And you can see that the AJ proxy load balancer just start to move traffic to this layer as well. So for example, when I have to patch all the MySQL slaves, I just took them one by one from production with scripts like that, run the upgrade scripts, put back to production, and iterate to the next, to the next, to the next. Of course, I could make that as playbooks as well, but there's a point when you can decide is that need to be automated or not. And you can see the load is just started to get spread up on that slave, and it's pretty cool, I guess. So I think that's all what I can show to you. I already had Puppet. Well, the question is why I don't really like Ansible for configuration management. I had Puppet before I started to use Ansible. And in that days, for me, it really looked like that Ansible is much easier to use, like ordering things to be done, than describing things. So for me, it is much easier to understand the process where, let's say you want to install Percona Toolkit on your server, and there's a playbook for install Percona Toolkit. You have first check if Percona Toolkit is installed or not, and if not, then you can run the command. Or you can use an Ansible module for RPM installation, which I'm pretty sure it is, but it's a module. You have to import a module. But if you use just Puppet, in Puppet you just say, for this role, there's a Percona toolkit which is installed, and that's all, and you don't have to do anything with that. I don't think that Ansible is bad. I mean, if I had a smaller business, I mean, I had to work on a smaller business, I probably wouldn't. Man, this language is so hard. So I probably won't be sure if I do want involve too much software for that. But in this size, it is much easier to have like this. How do I generate my inventory file? No. The inventory file is made from two parts in our system, because I have two kinds of servers. One kind of servers is the backend servers, like the MySQL, RabbitMQ servers, Redis servers, and stuff like that, which I don't change. And they are right now just put into a single file. And the other part of this host of mine are the application servers. And the application servers, I treated like if an application server is responding on the HTTP port, which we use, then the NetScaler or load balancer will report that server is available. And we have a Python script, which exactly just asks the NetScaler if the host is available or not. And if the host is not available, then it just removes it from the inventory. But I'm pretty sure that the next iteration, because everything is just changed, and that's nice, will be a console template for Ansible playbook, for Ansible host file, because that could be a good way to solve that. Or whatever you want, I mean, it's open source. I think that's a really good approach. You can just give a script name for Ansible to use as an inventory, and that is a really good approach for that. In fact, if I have a file on the admin servers, which is actually the playbook file and the Ansible host file, and use that. And on scripts which have to work on the application servers, this playbook is just a generated one. So it's just called with dashes and dash something and so on. Anybody has one more question? It was pretty longer than I expected, so it's cool so far. Thank you for attending here.